morning, students. This is my lecture number 2 for class 12th, subject English, chapter number Lost Spring, second account by Annie's Jung. In this chapter, we will cover the following value points mentioned on the screen. Introduction of the account 2, I want to drive a car, the main protagonist Mukesh, his living conditions, hazards of working at Bengal industry, the reason for not organizing themselves into a cooperative, explanation of two distinct worlds, Mukesh's attitude towards its situation.
We shall begin with the introduction of account 2 of Lost Spring. The account begins with the line, I want to drive a car. Here I stands for Mukesh, the main protagonist of this account. In this second account, the author Annie's Jung mentions about children having dreams in their eyes but are unable to fulfill those dreams because of the working traditions which their families have been following for long. And she tells about Mukesh, who wants to be a motor mechanic. He insists on being his own master. But like Sahib of first account, he is also not able to have his dream fulfilled because his family also does not allow him to go ahead to fulfill his dream, but they force him to work and follow the same family tradition of working. Now, we shall come to know about the main protagonist of the chapter, Mukesh. The main protagonist of the second account is Mukesh. The author sheds light on him as another victim of child labor. He has a dream of becoming a motor mechanic, but is bound to work in the bangle making industry in Firozabad due to work culture of his family. Mukesh lives a dream in his eyes of becoming a motor mechanic. Though he knows the garage which is miles away from his residence, but he is ready to walk those miles in order to reach the garage on his foot so that he can excel himself in learning the art of repairing motors. For that he is ready to sacrifice. He is ready to be dared enough to go against the family culture of working in Bengal industry. He says he knows the garage is miles away, but he is ready to walk and he insists that he wants to learn how to drive a car. And he is dared enough to show the courage, but he needs only and only the approval of his father and maybe the approval of his elder brother. Though he knows the people are not going to support him, but still he keeps the dream of becoming a motor mechanic alive in his eyes. Now, Mukesh's living conditions. Mukesh lives in a poor family. Children like Mukesh are living in Firozabad, where they walk down stinking lanes choked with garbage, houses with crumbling walls, wobbly doors, no ventilation, crowded with families of humans and animals coexisting in half-built shacks. Shacks means huts. And people spend most of their time and space in front of glass furnaces with high temperatures in dingy cells without air and light. The people have been living in this pathetic condition because the people have no money to upgrade their living standard. The lifetime achievement of Mukesh's father was to rebuild the house for his family, and in his entire life, he could not send Mukesh or his elder brother to school for getting education at all. And Mukesh also lives in that pathetic condition, and the people have willingly accepted those living conditions because somebody has rightly said that our lifestyle depends on our economic status. As much wealthy we are, that much good status and the living conditions we can afford for oneself. But the people are living in very pathetic condition over there. Their living standard is really miserable, that the people have a small room and they are living in the room with the animals even. And Mukesh has four members in his house. Mukesh, his father, his elder brother and his elder brother's wife. They have been living for years in a single room where they find the room fills with smoke when his sister-in-law cooks food for the entire family. But uncomplainingly, she also has been staying with all the three men of the family there because they have no other option possible, and the people do not think beyond, and they do not let their children to think beyond. Therefore, the people have been sacrificing their living standard in those half-built shacks. Now, we will know about the bangle industry at Firozabad and its hazards for the people working over there. Firozabad is famous for its bangle industry. Every other family in Firozabad is engaged in making bangles. It is the center of India's glass blowing industry, where families have spent generations working around furnaces, welding glass, making bangles for all the women in the land, it seems. Though the people know there are many hazardous impacts on children working there at bangle industry, but still the people force their children to work over there like them. They are unaware of the fact that the children are the future builders, the nation builders. They must have to go to school. Irrespective of the fact, children like Mukesh are forced to work in the glass furnaces with high temperatures and lack of proper ventilation. Their eyes get adjusted more to dark than to light. They work without any protective eyes gear, which leaves them blind at an early age. They lose the brightness of their eyes. Even burns and cuts are quite common, and they are prone to ailments such as lung cancer. Not only Mukesh, but his father and his father's father, that was grandfather of Mukesh, also went blind at an early age. The reason behind is the people work round the clock in front of the furnaces in dingy cells with lack of proper ventilation and high temperature. The people work there from morning till night, therefore their eyes get adjusted more to dark than to light. They know nothing other than the bangle industry. The entire time and space of their life goes into the bangle industry, and every other family is engaged in making bangles. Even very small children work there, irrespective of the fact whether they know the sanctity of making bangles over there or not. When the author asks Mukesh that why the people are not organizing themselves into cooperative to be dared enough to fight for their rights, then there is a reason for not organizing themselves into cooperative. It is apprehended if they get organized, then they are the ones who would be hauled up by the police, beaten and dragged to jail for doing something illegal. Because there is no leader among them, no one who can help them see things differently. They talk endlessly in a spiral that moves from poverty to apathy, to greed and to injustice. There are the people who have fallen into the vicious circle of middlemen who trap their fathers and forefathers. The people are dancing onto the tunes of all these middlemen and policemen. The people work like puppets, those who cannot take decisions of their own, but the people are forced to work under their different bosses who guide them to move from one aim to another, and they keep them limited working in the bangle industry. Small children produce better work and they are unaware about the wages that they have worked this much, so they must be paid that much. And all those bureaucrats, politicians take advantage of their not organizing themselves into cooperative. This is the reason that the people are still working in the hazardous conditions. After listening the reason for not organizing themselves into a cooperative, the author sees two distinct worlds there in Firozabad. One of the family caught in the web of poverty, burdened by the stigma of caste in which they are born. The other is a vicious circle of the sahukars, the middlemen, the policemen, the keepers of the law, the bureaucrats and the politicians. Together they have imposed the baggage on poor children that they can't put down. Before they are aware, they accept it as naturally as their fathers. To do anything else would mean to dare, and daring is not a part of his growing up. People are not dared enough to raise their voice against the second world that the author sees in Firozabad. The people are scared of the middlemen, the policemen, etc. Therefore, they have surrendered themselves and they are just perfecting themselves into the art of making bangles, and they are not ready to think beyond, not even for self or for the future generation of their own. At last, the author Anis Jung finds Mukesh different from the people living in the vicious circle of the poverty in Firozabad. She finds this boy is quite different and his attitude towards his situation is different from that of his family. His attitude is different. Unlike his family members and others of his community, he has dared to dream. He wants to be a motor mechanic. He wants to drive a car. And the resolute boy is willing to walk a long distance from his home to learn to be a mechanic, exemplifying the saying, where there is a will, there is a way. His grandmother's words about the unbreakable lineage represents the attitude of other people that they have towards their situation in life. They believe it is their destiny to toil as bangle makers only. But Mukesh's dream is better and is for his safer career. This resolute boy is very much willing to learn this art of repairing the motors. Though the writer asks him if he wants to fly an aeroplane, he is quite clear about his destination and about his resolution of becoming a motor mechanic. And in order to fulfill his dream, he only wants the support and approval of his family. And he is waiting for the approval. The boy is resolute enough. Therefore, Mukesh's attitude is quite different from that of his family. And now it is the end of the chapter that we studied, Lost Spring by Anis Jung, the second account about the boy named Mukesh and his living conditions, hazards of working at bangle industry, and how the people are not able to organize themselves into cooperative. And Mukesh's attitude, which is quite different from other members of his family, because he lives a dream, and that is the right of every other child in India and abroad like Mukesh to have a dream, and there must be great resolution to fulfill those dreams. Thank you. This is the end of the lecture. Children, you have to complete the homework on the basis of understanding the chapter explained by me. Question number 1 to 3 given on page number 20 in your Flamingo book. And understanding the text, question number 1 to 3. Talking about the text, question number 3 only. This is the homework that you are supposed to do on the basis of understanding the chapter. Thank you. Have a nice day.